Listening Library presents She Persisted, Margaret Chase Smith, by Ruby Shamir and Chelsea Clinton. Inspired by She Persisted, by Chelsea Clinton and Alexandra Boiger. Read for you by Keylor, Leigh, with a letter written and read by Chelsea Clinton. In memory of Safta Rachel, who persisted through extreme adversity to build a new life in her new country.
Dear reader, as Sally Ride and Marion Wright Edelman both powerfully said, you can't be what you can't see. When Sally Ride said that, she meant that it was hard to dream of being an astronaut like she was, or a doctor, or an athlete, or anything at all, if you didn't see someone like you who had already lived that dream. She especially was talking about seeing women in jobs that historically were held by men. I wrote the first She Persisted and the books that came after it because I wanted young girls and children of all genders to see women who worked hard to live their dreams. And I wanted all of us to see examples of persistence in the face of different challenges to help inspire us in our own lives. I'm so thrilled now to partner with the Sisterhood of Writers to bring longer, more in-depth versions of these stories of women's persistence and achievement to readers. I hope you enjoy these chapter books as much as I do and find them inspiring and empowering. And remember, if anyone ever tells you no, if anyone ever says your voice isn't important or your dreams are too big, remember these women. They persisted, and so should you. Warmly, Chelsea Clinton.
Chapter 1, Reaching High on Tippy Toes. When Margaret Chase was a little girl, no one would have thought to ask what she wanted to be when she grew up. In those days, it didn't much matter what a girl wanted to be, because there were very real limits on what she could be. She was supposed to get married to a man and be a mother. And if she had to work outside the home to make money, there were very few jobs for which she would be hired. Maybe a maid, or a teacher, or a waitress, or a store clerk. Women weren't expected to be much else, and more than that, they weren't supposed to want much else. Women weren't expected to have ambition, goals or dreams that they could work hard to make happen. But from the start, Margaret had ambition. She wanted to build her own future in her own way. Margaret was born on December 14, 1897, and grew up in the mill town of Skowhegan, Maine, a largely white community where many people worked in the factories along the Kennebec River. Her father was a barber, and her mother was a waitress and a store clerk and washed other people's laundry. Her family worked hard for everything they had, which included a horse, a pig, a cow, and some chickens. They grew vegetables in their garden and had window boxes filled with flowers in the spring. The oldest of six kids, Margaret became her mother's partner in taking care of the house and the other children. Margaret didn't mind. She loved and admired her mother, and she loved to work, especially once she figured out that hard work was the key to a different kind of future. "I went to work because I wanted to be independent," she said. "I wanted to spend my own money as I wanted to. And I did. That is exactly what I did." When Margaret was 12, she tried to get a job at a small store in town, but she couldn't reach the merchandise on the high shelf behind the counter. The shop owner joked that she should apply for the job later when she was taller. But it wasn't a joke to Margaret. She was serious about working there. And once she was 13 years old, she finally was tall enough to reach the top shelf standing on her tippy toes. She got the job. It was the first of many jobs Margaret would have. She was a quick learner and a hard worker, and always impressed her bosses. While she was in high school, she got her second job as a telephone operator. In the early 1900s, long before anyone had a cell phone, few people even had telephones in their homes, but those who did couldn't call each other directly. To reach someone by telephone, callers would first have to phone a switchboard operator. The operator would then connect callers to whomever they wanted to talk to. For this job, Margaret had to memorize the telephone directory and learn the technical skills to connect the calls, chatting with the callers all the while. The work put her at the center of what was happening in town and showed her how the people in her community were linked to one another. She also found she could be a helper, connecting people to doctors, firefighters, and police officers during emergencies. It was through this work that, at age 16, she met Clyde Smith, a well-known and well-liked businessman who was more than 20 years older than her. He had run as a candidate for some local elections and won. As Skowhegan's first selectman, which was a bit like being the mayor, he ran town meetings and oversaw a lot of town business. When Margaret was 17, Clyde offered her a job in his office, keeping and updating important records for the town. She got her first real taste of politics and public service, helping him help others and learning from him. Margaret liked high school and enjoyed playing for the championship girls' basketball team, but she loved her work best. It gave her a sense of freedom and her own money, so she didn't have to depend on anyone else. It was through her work that she could stretch herself on her tippy toes if she had to, and reach heights she hadn't yet even imagined. Chapter 2, Leaping into the Future. By the time Margaret graduated from high school in 1916, women's roles and opportunities were starting to change a bit. Women did not yet have the right to vote, but they were actively fighting for it, and more young women began working in more types of jobs. Even fashion changed. Women began to cut their hair shorter, dress in skirts that rose above their ankles, and wear lipstick. Margaret took part in those changes. As more women worked in professional jobs, they began to meet and talk about how to be more successful in their careers. Margaret soon joined them at the Business and Professional Women's Clubs, also called the BPW. In the BPW, she met women like her, women who had ambition. She was well-liked and good at getting things done. But most of all, she worked hard and had an independent spirit. She did things her own way, which other women in the BPW admired. Margaret also discovered that she was a leader. She became president of the BPW of Maine when she was 27. At the time, she was the youngest woman to reach that position. She also continued to be a superb worker in job after job, at the telephone company and later at the weekly newspaper, and after that, at a really tough job where she was in charge of much more experienced workers at a wool mill. She even ran for local office to be a member of the Skowhegan Town Committee and won re-election twice. She didn't know very much about politics, she later said, but I knew everybody and everybody knew me. It was just a.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.